Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Greater Story, My Rescue, Your Purpose, and Our Place in God's Plan by Sam Collier. Narrated by Sam Collier. I would like to dedicate this book to my mom and dad, the ones that adopted me, Lamar and Belinda Collier. You saved my life. And to my twin sister, Sarah, you gave me a life to fight for. The words that changed everything. Every miracle is a reaction to the impossible. I would dare say that without the impossible, miracles would not be needed. Are you in need of a miracle? If so, I'm glad you're listening to this book because I was. My hope for you as we travel through what some would say is an inconceivable journey, which is my life, is that you would be inspired. Not only inspired, but also filled with an unwavering hope that if God could do it for me, He can do it for you too. Here's my miracle story. It was the fall of 2013 when my family and I found ourselves sitting inside a small studio within the 37-story NBC Tower in downtown Chicago, by way of Atlanta, Georgia. That was our first time in the Windy City. My twin sister Sarah, my father, Lamar, and my mother, Belinda, had traveled from Atlanta to be there. And now we were being taken through hair and makeup and ushered around by the senior producer, a woman named Dorothy. She seated my mom and dad in the front row of the live studio audience and Sarah and me on the couch right next to Steve Harvey, the Steve Harvey, the mogul, comedian, award-winning radio personality, producer, actor, author, and most relevant to my story, television mega host. He was everywhere, doing everything, it seemed, including humbly helping a pair of 24-year-old twins find their birth mom, or at least trying to help. A year prior to this turn of events, we Colliers were sitting in the living room at the family house watching a Falcons game when Dad broke the only rule he'd ever given us in relation to watching football. Are you ready? Here it goes. No one talks during the game. He waited quietly until a random fourth down and then hollered, "You know what you need to do?" It wasn't a question. We knew better than to holler back, even as our expressions communicated our shock. "You need to go find your parents," Dad said, his voice still raised. What you must understand about my father is that hollering was normal for him. I doubt he even knew he was doing it. In his head, he was speaking at a normal pitch, but to us, hollering, no question. Still, we forgave him. He's from that part of the country where everyone shouts and thinks it's normal. "What are you talking about?" I remember asking him. As a family, the subject of finding our birth mother was new. Sarah and I had never been interested or uninterested in finding anyone or anything, because we'd never really felt that anything was lost. "Well, you need to know where you came from," Dad said. "You're getting older, and I think it might be time. I mean, you don't want to grow up and marry your cousin, do you? Because that could happen. You could marry your sister or your brother, and you'd never know it." Sarah and I both side-eyed him, chuckled, and thought, "So that's your argument, huh?" Although we didn't admit it, Dad was right. My sister and I wouldn't have known our biological cousins or siblings if they were staring us in the face. Dad then went on to holler, "And another thing, God told me Steve Harvey is going to help you do it. If he can't help you, no one can." It was in that moment I got up and left. "Dad," I said as I walked out the door, "I think you've lost your mind." I told my sister that she was in charge of this craziness and left. "I'm sorry to tell you that nothing turned up," senior producer Dorothy had told my family. The show's producers had received Sarah's letter a month prior, explaining that we'd been given up for adoption at birth and wanted to reunite with our biological mother and siblings if we had any. "We know that if anyone can help us," she'd written, "it's Steve Harvey." But evidently, even Steve Harvey has his limits. He had tried everything, we were told, but all roads led to a dead end. Still, the producer had been kind and offered, "If you'd like to come on the show and make a plea to the nation to help you find your mother, we will pay your way here and back. You and your parents, too. It would be a nice addition to our week-long Mother's Day specials." Figuring we had nothing to lose, we'd flown to Chicago and were sitting on the set, waiting as an assistant cued the audience for applause to bring us in from a commercial break. "Sam, let me ask you, what do you know about your birth mother?" Steve Harvey said. The truth is, we didn't know much. As we prepared for the show, Mom unlocked the safe and pulled out our decades-old adoption paperwork, about 100 pages of it, that communicated the hard facts of our origin story. That we'd been born to a broken mother who, in her crossroads moment, decided that our best shot at life was the foster care system or adoption. As I stood at the Kinko's copy center at 2 a.m, photocopying those dozens upon dozens of pages to send to Steve Harvey's team, I gathered up the details of my mother's circumstances. Her legal name, Eleanor Lynette Redden. Age, 21. Residence, Augusta, Georgia. Marital status, single. There was evidence of welfare and extreme poverty. There were child protective services reports and claims of prostitution. There were indications of the use of hard drugs, crack and cocaine among them. There were plentiful facts about our mother, but the news on our father was thin. The general consensus, as far as we could tell, was that he had completely deserted our bio mom and was consistently strung out on drugs. Nobody would have blamed me for holding on to rage for that man, but my posture toward him was warm. Was this because I had been raised by a loving dad? Maybe. But context has a way of providing clarity and creating empathy. Given the era my biological father grew up in, he was probably just doing what he had seen older men do. Like so many African-American men of his generation, he was a product of the social, economic, and environmental factors at work in the world around him. The prevailing emotion I felt as I read about him was something resembling pity. What a terrible set of circumstances he had. What a frustrating way to live. As I continued to read, I discovered that my bio mom and bio dad had had more kids before Sarah and I came along. This unbelievable realization struck me under the copy center's fluorescent lights. I had a brother. I had two more sisters. This news struck me as insane. Three young kids, three mouths to feed. And then along came twins. Even a mature, emotionally stable woman could have buckled under the weight of that. For my mother, I imagined, it crushed her. People who study drug addiction say that smoking crack consistently causes the user to experience a terrible mix of emotions, including irritability, anxiety, depression, aggression, and paranoid behavior. Yes, the highs are high, but the lows are equally low. So in addition to facing all the usual fears associated with being a young, poor, single mother, our mom probably dealt with at least some of those crippling effects. Sarah and I consider ourselves blessed that we were given the gift of life in the first place. Many women who find themselves where our bio mom found herself would have chosen abortion over adoption. Whatever her motivations and whatever her reality, I like to believe that her decision to give us up had been based in love, even if it hadn't been. She let go of us and sent us up the river like the baby Moses in a basket, trusting that God would meet us, hoping that someone would find us, believing that somehow, some way, we'd be all right in the end. The twins are looking for their birth mother, Steve Harvey was saying, and their adoptive parents support this search. They're here, in fact, Lamar and Belinda. Would you stand? The only mom and dad Sarah and I have ever known stood up from their seats in the front row as the crowd around them erupted with applause. From the couch where we were sitting, we looked at them with pride. They were our heroes, our rescuers, our version of Jesus. Out the corner of my eye, I took in my twin sister embodying all the beauty of a woman mixed with an uneasy smile in regard to who might enter the stage. If Sarah was an actress, she could easily be cast as Serena Williams in an HBO movie special. My sister is a combination of academic smarts and physical fitness. She can float through complicated calculus problems as if she were playing tic-tac-toe and focus on staying physically fit like an Olympic athlete. With espresso brown skin and eyes that always warm my soul, Sarah is simply breathtaking. That day, she was sporting a short, curly, cropped hairstyle, which allowed her high cheekbones to command attention. Looking at my mom in the audience, I knew the viewers would define her resting face as a genuine smile. A tall, slender, graceful woman, my mom could easily pass for a long-distance runner. Her caramel skin tone accentuates her compassionate eyes and intuitive nature. I think my dad's honesty shows up in his face. His eyes tell a story of triumph through faithfulness. He could be described as having an average build, but his broad shoulders give him a soldier-like frame. Looking at him in the audience, I realized how all my life I had thought he could fix anything, solve any puzzle, stay calm through any crisis. I still believe that to be true. My dad had been to every basketball game I'd ever played. All along the way, my mom made sure that Sarah and I were given every educational opportunity any child could ever have. They'd introduced us to the living God, Jesus Christ Himself. They loved us. And for the millionth time, there they were, laying aside their own agenda to help Sarah and me further God's plans for us. Their dad was again being dad, standing at attention, living in the moment, clapping with the audience as Steve asked him and my mom to stand. They deserve every moment of this applause and more, I thought to myself. Man, my parents are the greatest. During that emotional moment, Steve Harvey looked at me and said, "Now, I know I said that we didn't find your birth mother, but that's not the case." He paused and then said the words that would change everything for Sarah and me. "Eleanor, come on out." Part one, you, here, and now. One, family matters. I sustain myself with the love a family, Maya Angelou. Family doesn't always mean blood. If you want to know one of the secrets to happiness in life, copy and paste that one onto your heart. When I was a kid, my dad had a barbershop, Silver Star Barbershop. Still today, all these years after Dad left that business, Silver Star stands strong. One of the oldest businesses in the Sweet Auburn district, an area known primarily for being the birthplace of the civil rights movement in Atlanta. Sweet Auburn is where Martin Luther King Jr.'s father pastored. Sweet Auburn is where Dr. King grew up. Sweet Auburn is where the historic Ebenezer Baptist Church and Dr. King's only organization, the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, reside. My dad's Silver Star Barbershop was nestled between history. I didn't know any of this as a kid, you realize. To me, it was just where Dad worked. Most Saturday mornings, I'd be awakened from a deep, peaceful sleep by my dad hollering, of course, "Sam, let's go. We gotta get down to the shop. Let's go." The truth was that I loved going down to the shop. What I didn't love was having an alarm clock that yelled. Now, in Dad's defense, my comatose state required a little hollering. From time to time, Dad would give up on trying to wake me and just leave me there to sleep. Around noon, I'd call him and ask why in the world he'd left me home. Are you serious? He said with a chuckle. Nuclear war couldn't have woken me up. I'd hang up the phone and slink back to bed, determined to not miss his wake-up hollering the next time. That next time would come, and I'd heed the call. Father and son, off to the Silver Star. Let's go, let's go, let's go. Our journey to the shop always began with a quick stop at Chick-fil-A to get Dad's morning coffee and two chicken biscuits. One for him, one for me. It was followed up by the sounds of Kiss 104.1 FM, the oldie station, with the fly jock Tom Joyner and his crew trash-talking us onto I-20 East. We'd munch our biscuits to the I-75-85 North interchange, where the fog would clear and our exit would appear. Auburn Avenue, there it was. We were close, and I was glad. I want you to think of the best of soul food dishes. Whether it's collard greens, baked chicken, fried chicken, mac and cheese, banana pudding, or barbecue. Imagine the aroma of these dishes being personified into the warmest and most secure hug on a cold day. That feeling is Auburn Avenue. Walking outside the Silver Star Barbershop, you'd see Henry's Grill and Lounge directly across the street. It was an old-fashioned restaurant with a big cursive neon sign on top of the building. To the left of the barbershop was Perot Beauty Salon, where women entered wearing scarves covering their heads and exited with beautiful permed, teased, or silky straight hairstyles from the pressing comb. The Royal Peacock, a once upscale nightclub boasting celebrity superstar performances by B.B. King, the Four Tops, and Atlanta's own Gladys Knight and the Pips, hosted reggae parties during my youth. A block up from the barbershop was the Atlanta Daily World newspaper, the first Black-owned daily and the African-American panoramic experience, Apex Museum. At the corner of Auburn Avenue and Piedmont Avenue was the Bow-style Atlanta Life Insurance Company complex. At the end of the block stood Big Bethel AME Church, or what I thought was a castle. The wide arches and a tower at the southern end, all covered with noble, rough-hewn stones, gave the church a Gothic feel. Perched on the top of the steeple was a white cross, and on the front as well as the back of the steeple were two blue neon cross signs with the words, "Jesus Saved." To this day, driving on I-75-85 at night and seeing the bright neon Jesus Saves sign cutting through the darkness provides me comfort on many nights. Auburn Avenue, a.k.a. Sweet Auburn, was the mecca for Black-owned businesses. Farther up Auburn Avenue, past the I-75-85 bridge, was the historic Ebenezer Baptist Church, where Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. became co-pastor with his father. Next door was the palatial Martin Luther King Jr. Center for Nonviolent Social Change, a memorial dedicated to Dr. King's legacy. Riding with my dad every Saturday to the barbershop, I never thought to visit Ebenezer Church or the King Center. During holidays or the summertime, I would see lines of tourists eagerly waiting to take photos of the pulpit Dr. King preached from or to see his worn Bible or wristwatch displayed in the King Center. I imagined parents trying to put Dr. King's legacy in context for a young mind to grasp the magnitude of this freedom fighter. With all that history right up the street, I never thought to enter the space and take in the sights. Listen, I was a kid, and the thought of Dr. King's legacy seemed to be such an out-of-reach story for me to wrap my brain around. Dad wasn't chatty on these trips. Keeping in line with his no-talking-during-football rule, these commutes were quiet. As a young boy who wanted nothing more than to be like his dad, I followed suit. Call your men were silent. I became silent, too. Filling in the space were area transit buses stopping and starting, homeless men shouting out their requests for cash, businessmen and Georgia State University students hustling and bustling through their morning routines. The city was jumping. Eventually, we'd arrive, and Dad would tug out his key ring stuffed full with keys. He'd jiggle the lock, open the door, and walk laps around the shop as he got everything ready for the day. Dad was always the first one to arrive, but shortly after, the rest of the Silver Star crew would come in. Black barbershops flow like a church service, you see. Someone is always there to open the door and start the day. And between worship and the word, everyone kind of trickles in. By the time the preacher gets up to preach, everyone is where they're supposed to be. In a black barbershop, the preacher is up by noon, 10 a.m. on Saturdays. The culture of his church centers on what's always on TV in his shop. How good the coffee is, which customers are regular, and what conversations are held. If you ever witnessed the sheer madness of a black barbershop debate, then you know it's not for the faint of heart. You'd better come with facts. You'd better come with passion. You'd better come with strength to go the distance. I used to love being a fly on the wall whenever Dad's staff and clients went at it. In his unassuming way, Dad served as a quiet referee who secretly loved to indulge a few fools. On one occasion, a Silver Star legend named Lucky started a debate about whether James Brown was the greatest recording artist of all time. This was the King of Soul he was talking about. Things got crazy fast, mostly because everyone forgot that Lucky's dad was once James Brown's bodyguard. James Brown is the king! Half the shop, including Lucky, were hollering, while the others hollered, "James Brown is trash!" Welcome to the Black Barbershop. Those fools were family to me. As crazy and fun as the debates were, they were also empowering to me. I was a young man trying to sort out my identity, my character, my place in the world. To be allowed to be present for those discussions marked me. From time to time, someone would even ask my opinion on the debate at hand, and while the invitation made me sweat bullets, I loved feeling included like that. Those men weren't just customers or employees. They were big brothers and uncles and dads. They knew my name. They loved me and my dad. They cared about the progress I was making with every year that passed. Hanging around them told me much of what I needed to know about how to make it in this world. If it takes a village to raise a kid, well, these men were that village for me. In this country, the term family historically has referred to a husband, a wife, and their biological offspring. Anything that doesn't run along those lines may be considered family, but only if you throw some descriptive words before or behind it. If your mom isn't married, you're in a single-parent family. If your mom or dad marries someone who has children of their own, you're probably a part of a blended family. If you're part of the LGBTQ community and have friends or partners who serve as your primary support system, you might be part of a chosen family. If you've been adopted, like me, then you may refer to the individuals whose DNA runs through you as your biological mother or biological father. With that in mind, woven throughout contemporary science, sociologists and anthropologists have talked in terms of degrees of kinship when analyzing how people fit into and behave inside of family units. For example, the children of a parent are first-degree kin, full biological siblings, half-siblings, and biological grandmothers, grandfathers, nieces, nephews, aunts, and uncles are second-degree kin. Half nieces, half nephews, first cousins, and more are third degree, whereas half first cousins are fourth degree. First cousins, once removed, are fifth, second cousins are sixth, and so on, right down the line. And with these degrees, we have great clarity. We have an answer to the question, who are you to me? Other than Sarah, the lines weren't exactly clear regarding my connection to another human being, which was cool with me because we'd been loved, accepted, and welcomed by an amazing mom and dad. We may not have had a ton of external wealth, but internal riches? We had buckets and buckets of it. Sarah and I are living proof that some of the poorest people in the world, materially speaking, are happier than some of the richest. Why? Because those poor ones have sorted out where true wealth really comes from. Kindness, patience, confidence, self-esteem, faith, integrity, love. These things were the glue that held our family together. Whatever lack I was supposed to be experiencing from the absence of my biological family, listen, I just didn't have. Researchers will tell you that the effects of maternal abandonment are almost always guaranteed to create substantial damage in the hearts and souls of its victims. There are evidently various forms that this type of abandonment can take, such as emotional maternal abandonment, where the mother is present with her children, in body but miles away in her heart and mind. Or psychological maternal abandonment, where the mother regards her kids with hatred or apathy, often neglecting them and not tending to their basic needs. But these experts in the field agree that by far the worst form of maternal abandonment is the physical one, where the mom literally just leaves. In the world of reptiles, abandonment is a part of their coming-of-age strategy. Snakes lay eggs filled with their babies, and even before those eggs hatch, the females exit stage left. Geckos do the very same thing. To create a closer parallel, panda moms, who almost always deliver twins, keep one with them and abandon the other to the woods. We read these facts and find ourselves resisting the urge to cringe. Aren't mothers hardwired to care for their young? We know there's something called maternal instinct, and regardless how fast and bright our independent streak runs, we still kind of expect moms to show up. This is why we just laugh when a baby starts to cry when his mother leaves the room. "Oh, it's okay," we say in a baby's voice, an attempt to convince the child that his mother will be right back. Until a child experiences the development that occurs during the sensory motor stage, the baby will always freak out. Why? Because until that point, I've learned, the baby believes that when an object disappears, it ceases to exist. If mom leaves the room, mom dies, which consequently makes the baby want to die too. How will I live without mama? But of course, his mom hasn't ceased to exist. She's just using the restroom. All moms eventually come back, right? Back to the abandonment research. When a child is physically abandoned by the one who birthed him, in nearly every instance, chaos ensues. The child wonders what he did wrong to make his mother leave. The child may feel guilty, even though he's not sure what he's feeling guilty about. Later in life, he may grow fearful of building relationships with other adults. Because look what happened to the first adult he knew. He may walk through life expecting every person he is around to leave at some point. He longs for his long-awaited reunion with mom. I mean, what other solution is there? As I develop the ability to evaluate the world around me, to put words to the world and my life, to make sense of all that I'd been through, I saw that none of the expected results for someone like me had come to pass. In other words, I never felt abandoned, nor did I experience what the research communicates. As far as I knew, our mother left and wasn't coming back, and that was a good thing for our future. I'd survived being abandoned by the woman who birthed me. I'd survived 2 months of foster care, 2 months of Benadryl in my milk to keep quiet because we were sickly and cared for poorly before the Colliers, Mom and Dad, showed up. I'd even survived being rejected by couples filled with familial anticipation who might have adopted Sarah and me, but didn't because of false prediction placed on my and Sarah's life by the short-sighted and, dare I say, racist agency director. You don't want them, she'd tell prospective adopting parents. Because of where they come from, they probably won't be much. Lately, whenever I speak to an audience or a congregation, I tell them that being from the Black church, I need some energy in the room. To get the crowd warmed up, I ask them to turn to someone they don't know, smile, and say, "You look good today." Like the responsible, upstanding citizens they follow suit, and the room quickly fills with encouragement and laughter as people receive a compliment that makes them feel good, even if it's not true. It's interesting to think back to my infant self and wonder if anyone back then had thought we looked good. I'm sure someone had to. I mean, look at me. joke. I'm just kidding. The truth is, our origin story attracted a dark cloud over us in that adoption home. That is, until Belinda and Lamar came by. "Oh, you don't want them," the director of the agency said. Their mama was a druggie and a prostitute, and their daddy loved him some crack cocaine. These kids are for sure going to have problems. That director believed that this was the truth of Sarah and me and treated us according to that truth. She'd leave me lying on one side of my head for weeks, causing my head to become misshapen over time. She'd put Benadryl, like I mentioned, in our bottles of formula. She never bent my sister's legs, leaving Sarah frustrated and stiff. When Mom and Dad found us, we were a mess. Still, they saw past all those barriers and blockages. To be a mother to a child, musician Alicia Keys writes, is the most brilliant gift.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.